And now, Michelob hopes you enjoy the special of the week. The Palomino, the best homegrown music showcase west of the Grand Ole Opry. On October 11, 1980, the crowds outside this Los Angeles club anxiously wait in line to see an artist who's just been dropped from his fourth record label. An artist unlike any other whose fans won't let him go. From the farthest reaches of the largest city in the country, from the young at heart to the young in age, they come as they have many times before, simply to hear a man sing his songs. Why?
I don't know. He's just been great since the late 60s when I first saw him.
Well, I've been waiting months to see him. I've written letters to the Palomino, and he's finally here.
I hear he puts on a great show.
Oh, man, I've been digging this stuff ever since the Kingston Trio, you know what I mean?
My favorite singer, almost.
Your almost favorite singer? You mean you know his songs?
Yeah. Do-do, 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 do-do. When the lights go down in the California town, people are in for the evening. Jump into my car and throw in my guitar. Heartbeat time of the British. Driving over Canaan, singing to a soul. People out there turning music into gold. Do-do, 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 do-do.
That's Susanna Morgan, and I'm Robert W. Morgan. This week, on the special of the week, the loneliness of the long-distance cult hero. He may not be Superman, Darth Vader, or Humphrey Bogart, but his fans love him just the way he is. Once a member of the Kingston Trio, he's been churning out music for almost 20 years, and he's been turning himself every which way but loose for the last 11, trying to turn his music into gold. As one member of his international fan club, I'm proud to say he's finally done it. John Stewart.
When the lights go down in the California town, people are in for the evening. I jump into my car and I throw in my guitar. My heart beat time with the breathing. Driving over Canaan, singing to my soul. There's people out there turning music into gold. My buddy Jim Bass, he's a working pump of gas, and he makes 250 for an hour. He's got rhythm in his hands as he's tapping on the cans, sings rock and roll in the shower. Driving over Canaan, singing to his soul. There's people out there turning music into gold.
It's only a song away, and I always thought about that over the 11 years. You know, it's only a muse away. It's only one song away. And there are people doing it every day. There are people out there turning music into gold. And the verses came easily after that. You know, where do you get the songs? I mean, just look on the street. I mean, every person out there is a song. Everyone's a story. You know, here we're living in California with the California girls, are the most beautiful girls in the world. And how could you not find a song? You know? Oddly enough, a hit song was a song about trying to get a hit song. It's like a tunnel of mirrors, right? Which came first, the hit or the song? I don't know.
Turning music into gold isn't just the domain of heavy metal groups. But for John Stewart, the gold rush was crawling along at an escargot's pace. After 7 phenomenal years with the Kingston Trio, John hopped from label to label, trying unsuccessfully to establish himself as a solo artist. His fortunes had dropped so low, he was even dropped by his friend Al Corey's record label, Capitol Records. But in 1977, John had a capital idea. Al Corey had just been named president of RSO Records. Wanting to be part of the new RSO family, John decided to appeal directly to his fans for help. And where did he take his stand? At the Palomino.
I did the same thing that a candidate for any office would do. I went to my constituents. I petitioned to continue doing what I do. I went to my strength, the people who buy the records and want the records. And the power of one letter is awesome because it represents not only a commitment from that person, but it represents people who don't write. Congressmen are very aware of that. So I figured if congressmen are aware of it, why wouldn't a record company president be aware of it? And it was something that never had been done, which really appealed to me.
Given any day, there's a jet flying somewhere. Or she bought a ticket and she vanished in the sky. How was I to know she was leaving in the morning? Never heard her go, she never said goodbye. I learned to love the night, cause the light's gonna get you right between the eyes in the morning.
artists came from London, England, they came from Colorado, they came from Hawaii, they came from Boston, Massachusetts. Disc jockeys sent letters and program directors sent letters, and it was a very moving thing for me, you know, very worthwhile thing, because I got to continue doing what I do.
Excuse me for interrupting your story, John, but I think it's time for me to step out of character. You see, more than with most artists, my path has crossed John Stewart's throughout our careers. That's why, for the first time in Special of the Week history, I interviewed myself for this week's show. Now back to our story. When Al Corey found 50 letters a week piling up on his new desk at RSO, he knew the postman rang more than twice, but Robert W. Morgan only rang once.
I said, Al, hire him, you know, put him on your label. He's got a hit in him, we know that, we all know that. And Al knew it too, but Al was a little bit afraid to take chances at that point, but Al's a chance taker and he took a chance. Took a chance with the Bee Gees. Took a chance with John Stewart.
Come on down, Miranda. Your window's open wide. Take a chance on a midnight dance so I can see it in your eyes.
Dream babies get born. That's next with John Stewart on the Special of the Week. I'm Robert W. Morgan. Mekolo brings you the 7-day weekend, smooth and mellow style.
Weekends can happen anytime. Weekends are just a frame of mind. So go ahead and pour that smooth and mellow beer. It's Mekolo.
When you listen to the John Stewart saga, you realize it took a long time for people to take him seriously. It isn't exactly like that with Michelob, probably because beer drinkers have recognized the quality of Michelob from the very first taste.
Go ahead, enjoy that smooth and mellow beer. It's Michelob. Put a little weekend in your week. Put a little weekend in your week.
Yeah.
Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri. I'm Robert W. Morgan on the special of the week with John Stewart. For John, signing with RSO was perhaps the last stop on a runaway train. But the first stop on that train was San Diego, California, where John was born.
My dad was on in years when I was born, so there was a great gap between father and son as far as growing up together. When I got married, I was 20, and I had my first child right away. So my son Michael is now 18, going to college, and we're like buddies, you know. It's great.
Willard, he's a loner, living by the railway, living by the tracks beside his home. Willard, he's a loner. If you're going his way, say hello, he ain't got no one to call his own. Soldiers of glass, standing by the trash, Willard's colored bottles in a line. Soldiers of glass, funny you should ask, but they're the only friends he has to pass the time. They're the only friends he has to pass the time. And his mama knows that he was once a child. Mama, she was the first one to hear us cry. And my mama knows that I was once a child. Could it be all just Willard in disguise? Could it be all just Willard in disguise?
I started writing immediately. As soon as I grabbed the guitar, I started to write. It just started coming out where I'd be playing Elvis Presley songs and Jerry Lee Lewis tunes. I was also writing my own tunes and started writing constantly at that point. Everything clicked in. As soon as I mastered a few chords, it all sort of fell into place.
Taking all the good times, put them in my pocket, save them for a rainy day. I'll be glad I got it. Put 'em in a trunk and lock it. Put 'em in a song and talk it. Gonna leave it in the music and rock it in my own sweet time. Gonna leave it in the music and rock it in my own sweet time. Moving with the rhythm, I'm never gonna leave behind. Can rock it in my own sweet time. This old guitar feels like loving that love of mine.
For John Stewart, like John Lennon, nothing mattered before Elvis Presley. But once bitten by rock and roll, John Stewart really began to buzz when a friend turned him on to a new group called the Kingston Trio.
Kingston Trio was playing at the Hungry Eye in San Francisco. They had just completed their first album on Capitol, and they had played at the college, and he said, you've got to hear this album. And I heard the album, and that was the second time that all my circuits were blown. I just went, what is that? I love the songs, I love the sound, I love the amateurishness of it. I didn't know at the time that's what it was, but that it was the anybody can do what kind of music. It seemed very accessible to me. And I immediately started writing folk songs and putting a folk group together and doing those things that all those people did in the early 60s when they first heard the Kingston Trio.
Throughout history, there have been many songs written about the Eternal Triangle. This next one tells the story of a Mr. Grayson, a beautiful woman, and a condemned man named Tom Dooley. When the sun rises tomorrow, Tom Dooley must hang.
Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you're bound to die. Poor boy, you're bound to die. Poor boy, you're bound to die. Poor boy, you're bound to die.
Starting in high school with a band called the Furies and later with his own folk rock trio, John Stewart was already trying to work his way into the music business. But when Dave Gard left the Kingston Trio in 1961, John, a backstage groupie, had a perfect shoe-in. He was tall.
Tall was important. Oh, yeah, the visual aspect of the trio was very important. There's the short guy, Nick Reynolds, the funny guy, Bob Shane, the sex symbol, and the guy in the middle was tall and sort of made the triangle. So tall was important. And the fact that I wrote songs helped a lot because the material was a problem for any group. And I knew what they were doing. I understood the trio. I was able to carry on what the trio was. It was that raw, amateurish sound where a real musician could have gone into the trio who played better than I did, who sang better than I did. And the trio would no longer have been the trio. There's something I've always believed in as far as making pop records or putting a group together, where when everyone is playing at the same level of incompetency, magic happens.
Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls pick them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn?
Filling in Dave Gard's shoes was nothing short of a tall order. When John Stewart joined the Kingston Trio in 1961 at the age of 21, they were already the number one group in the country. But while it didn't take long for John to feel like a member, the group actually never made him one. And the long and the short of that was that John Stewart got the short end of a very long stick.
In 1965, 64, you could live real good on $500 a week. And I made a lot of money off the songwriting. I did real good on that. So I wasn't hurting, and I was just real young and naive and wide-eyed, and as the trio wound down, I got very upset about it, and was one of the reasons for me leaving the trio and the trio disbanding. That was just one of the reasons, but it did come to a head. I am sorry that I wasn't part of it. And groups that have members come and go now, I know, split it with a new member. So I was had.
Some people say I'm a no-count. Others say I'm no good, but I'm just a natural born traveling man, doing what I think I should. Oh yeah, doing what I think I should. And I don't give a damn about a greenback guitar. Spend it fast as I can, or a wailing song and a good guitar. The only things that I understand, oh boy, the only things that I understand.
Although the Kingston Trio had created a totally original sound that initiated the folk movement of the early 60s, by the late 60s, even John Stewart didn't give a hoot about hootenannies. So, 7 years and 22 albums later, John told the other members of the trio, it ain't me, babe.
I just went crazy. You know, I was just absolutely bananas. And I heard Dylan, and I heard Tim Hart, And I wanted to be a singer-songwriter. I wanted to be one of those guys out there singing his own tunes. And the trio had stopped recording, pretty much. And I was going to sing with John Denver at that point. We were going to be a duo. And we rehearsed Daydream Believer, and we rehearsed Leaving on a Jet Plane, and a couple of other songs. And that was my annuity. That was one of the songs I was going out with on my own. And a friend of mine, Chip Douglas, who oddly enough was one of the three guys up for Dave Guard's job in the Kingston Trio, at that point was producing the Monkees, and he said, do you have a tune? And I said, yeah, I've got this one song. And he heard it and said, yeah, that'd be great, let me do it. Give us the publishing, which I did gladly. And it was a huge hit. It was an astronomical hit.
Oh, I could hide 'neath the wings of the bluebird as she sings. The 6 o'clock alarm would never ring, but it rings and I rise, wipe the sleep out of my eyes. My shaven razor's cold and it stings. Me as a white knight on his steed. Now you know how happy I can be. Oh, and our good time starts and ends without dollar one to spend. But how much, baby, do we really need? Cheer up, sleep. To a daydream believer and a homecoming queen. Cheer up, sleepy Jean. Oh, what can it mean to a daydream believer and a homecoming queen?
From Breadlines to Bloodlines. That's next with John Stewart on the Special of the Week. I'm Robert W. Morgan. Discouraged by their stagnation and hungry to pursue a solo career, John gave the Kingston Trio notice. And with that, the two remaining members noticed their time had also come.
I gave my year's notice, and my best friend that I have in the whole world, Nick Reynolds, said, yeah, well, I've been doing this for 10 years. I think I want to get off the road. So we planned the farewell tour of the country and did a farewell 2 weeks at the Hungry Eye, and that was it. The night we finished our last show, Nick and I drove down to Monterey for the first night of the Monterey Pop Festival, so it was really a fitting and clean ending.
I often get the feeling that I'm talking to the wind and no one hears. No one listens in. Then I start singing songs, and the music makes the whole world feel like home. Sing a song and you're not alone. Lily McLean, you are standing in the rain and you are cold. You are hungry and afraid. You are waiting for a sunrise. A sunrise makes you feel so very small. Darling Lily, aren't we?
some healing in this song.
It was a very emotional, traumatic experience. It was, you know, like the end of our marriage. Here was, you know, my best friend Nick Reynolds that I sang with for 7 years and had a salary coming in every week, and my life was mapped out for me, and all of a sudden I was on my own. And I also had that enthusiasm of a new venture, not realizing how damn tough it was going to be, having no idea how hard it was going to be. And it was a real drain.
But you can't look back when you're moving on. But you can't look back, buddy, you got to go and sing your song. Where did they go? All the good times I used to know. Long time ago, I loved a woman. I loved a woman, never let her know. But you can't look back when you're moving on. But you can't look back, buddy, you got to go and sing your song. But you can't look back when you're moving on. But you can't look back, buddy, you got to go and sing your song.
With the trio gone and John Denver high in the Rocky Mountains, John Stewart stepped out, but not quite alone. With Buffy Ford, he put out an album called Signals Through the Glass, an unsuccessful venture that signaled to John that he had better get off his glass and get down to business. And that's exactly what he did with his next album, California Bloodlines.
Couldn't ask for better reviews or long-lasting comments of greatness about an album. I just got very lucky on that album. There were good songs, and Nick Fanay took me to Nashville, and the players in Nashville were very tuned in and eager to play with California people. And it was a very magical time, and it showed up on the album. But it didn't sell really anything at all.
She believes the witches fly crazy across the moon. She believes an angel hides in the corner of her room. She believes the ships come home singing from the sea. She believes in losers, oh, she believes in me. She believes a pot of gold marks the rainbow's end. The light will show the lonesome homeward friend. She believes the weary soul one day will be free. She believes in losers, oh, she believes in me.
An English guy named Paul Gambaccini polled reviewers all over the world for the top 200 albums of all time. And California Bloodlines was number 36 or something out of the 200. It just floored me. I mean, I don't buy it for a minute.
Had I been born in New York City, a New York City girl I'd know. Working in the concrete, not the sunlight. Living in that New York rain and snow. There's California bloodlines in my heart, and the California woman in my song. There's California bloodlines in my heart, and the California heartbeat in my soul. To think I might have never known you if I had lived my life in Tennessee. But I really could have never let that happen, for you in California are in me. There's California bloodlines in my heart,
California woman in my song. There's California bloodlines in my heart, and the California heartbeat in my soul.
John Stewart joins me on another show, next on the special of the week. I'm Robert W. Morgan. Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri. I'm Robert W. Morgan on the special of the week with John Stewart. Now, as I mentioned earlier, my career has been so intertwined with John's, I decided to interview myself for this week's special. Well, when California Bloodlines was released in 1969, it wasn't only acclaimed by the critics, it hit home with insomniacs, like me, for example.
One night I couldn't sleep, I was up, it was 3 o'clock in the morning. I had the radio on, and I heard this record. At the time, I was co-producing and hosting one of those dance TV shows locally in Los Angeles. And I called up the person I was producing with, and I said, Judy, there's a song I just heard on the radio, and you've got to find me the person who wrote that song. At that time, we were looking for somebody to co-host a show with me. Somebody to co-host the show was also a musician who could sing live. And this kind of material was exactly what I was looking for, and the guy had a quality in his voice that blew me away. I said, I don't care what you have to do, but find out who wrote, who sang that song, and get him to me. So about 2 months later, I end up in a motel coffee shop on Fairfax Avenue in Los Angeles with John, and I talked him into moving down from Northern California to do 26 weeks with me on a live dance show on TV, which he, to this day, still regrets, although we had a lot of fun doing it. And the song was July Air Woman, and it just blew me away. First of all, the title, and then the whole treatment, I just couldn't stand it.
I can't hold it on the road when you're sitting right beside me and I'm drunk out of my mind merely from the fact that you are here. And I have not been known as the saint of San Joaquin, and I'd just as soon right now pull on over to the side of the road and show you what I mean. July, you're a woman more than anyone I've ever known.
What a guy. We had an afternoon show and I came on and did July You're a Woman, which was my hit, non-hit record. And then he called one day and said, look, we're going to do this afternoon TV show. It's a new concept, and I want you to do it with me. And I thought it sounded like a lot of fun, so I did it. We did a TV show together on Channel 9 every afternoon for about, I don't know, it seems it could either have been a week or a year. It's a few months. We had a -3 rating. Bob and I would go up and see the program director after the show, and he'd say, you guys cannot do this anymore. And it was a lot of fun. It was absolutely crazy, but not what I was suited to do.
We will find the golden road somewhere down the line. If we don't, we all were sold somewhere down the line. When we were young and we shined, and I believe it's getting closer all the time. We will find the golden somewhere down.
And Bob would be leaving the house in the morning. One morning, I remember he was leaving, and he had his hair dryer, and the cops stopped him because they thought it was a gun, and Bob, you know, went crazy over that. So we did the dryer of Navarone that day, and we brought in this big hair dryer from a beauty salon, and we were fighting Indians with hair dryers, and it was absolutely crazy.
Oh, yeah, that's right, the dryer. I've forgotten about that, the dryer of Navarone. What got me was it wasn't even plugged in.
You do not truck with Robert W. Morgan. And yet, underneath that is a very gentle, sentimental guy. He's just a marshmallow inside.
It takes one to know one. He is, too. Well, I'm not tough on the outside, am I? Well, I'm a toasted marshmallow. You have to stay tough to survive in North Hollywood.
I still can remember Pa coming home drunk with the boys from the Union Hall Station. And it's hard to believe all the words that I read. We are living in God's favorite nation. And I knew he was ill from the size of his pills, but he choked on the preacher's salvation. And I know that his blood, it still flows in my veins as I fall for each blue-eyed temptation. And the razorback woman who stood by his side is skinny and fixing to die. Oh, the razorback woman is calling me home and she cries. Oh my God, how she cries.
You know, a lot of people have wondered what the W in Robert W. Morgan stands for. Well, I'm not at liberty to divulge that information, but I will tell you how my daughter, Susanna, got her name.
I have a middle name and I've always hated. My mother loved it. It was named after one of my uncles. So I was always called that name when I was a kid. I finally got to high school. There's a new school now, and I changed the roles myself to Bob Morgan instead of what I was being called before. And I lived with this awful name, people making fun of it for so many years. I vowed that if I ever had a child, I was going to give him or her a good name. But then I thought, well, how in the hell am I qualified to do that? My mother thought she was giving me a great name, too. So John has always been great with names. A lot of his songs have names in them, most of them do. So I called John. I said, John, I need a name for my daughter or son. At that time, we were convinced it was going to be a boy. He says, let me think about the boy, but if it's a girl, I said, gee, I've always liked the name Susanna. And then I remembered the song Missouri Birds from the California Bloodlines album. And he sings about Susanna in there, and I boomed. I just fell out, and I said, that's it. And I started hoping for the girl, right? Got to have a girl, because they're really going to laugh at a boy named Susanna.
Missouri Birds. Lying over old St. Louis. Hear that song they're singing to me. Go into the world while you're young. But the preacher's words echo from the old church steeple. Stay here with the decent people. Settle down and marry while you're young. If I go into the world, Susanna, oh, if I go into the world, Susanna.
tell you what I've seen. The seeds of change. Go across the churchyard to me. Tombstone faces see right through me. Today so soon, tomorrow, and you're old, old. If I go into the world, Susanna, oh, will you wait for me? If I go Missouri birds, flying over old St. Louis, hear that song they're singing to me, going to the world while you're young, while
John Stewart says, bombs away, next on the special of the week. I'm Robert W. Morgan. I'm Robert W. Morgan with John Stewart on the special of the week. You know, I have to tell you, probably nobody is a bigger John Stewart groupie than Robert W. Morgan himself. When I get depressed, I lock myself in my den, put on a John Stewart album, usually California Bloodlines, and by the time I've listened to it, I'm ready to face the world again. But although fans around the world have always responded similarly to something the Lonesome Picker has to say, John's records have seldom said it in terms of sales, and that's caused him to run up against defeat again and again.
It's a business, but it was frustrating. And you get a lot of self-doubts, and it's very hard to keep your creative juices going and your enthusiasm going when you put out a record and it goes plop, you know, put out another one, plop. But there were people like Bob Morgan, and there were fans who would come to the shows who the songs meant a lot to, it meant a great deal to them. And that was a great incentive to keep going.
When your wings no longer catch the wind, your wheels are throwing sparks from concrete on the rim. And when you run so long and you run so hard, you're feeling every stone beneath your feet as they repeat that when you run alone. And when your dreams are all just flashbacks, and you're crying beneath the wisecracks, I've been here before, and there is no more. And when you've run so hard and you're worn so thin, you find that losing's just another way to win. It is time for you to begin to be wings. Wheels, and to know how it feels to be you on your own. 'Cause when you run, oh, you run.
Bombs away, dream babies is a phrase that Dave Guard uses all the time, which is, it means this is it, you know. This is the whole shooting match. Bombs away, dream babies. The family jewels are riding on red seven, you know. We either will do it or we won't.
Bombs Away, Dream Babies, produced by Lindsey Buckingham of Fleetwood Mac, contained John Stewart's greatest hit, Gold. But his follow-up album in 1980, Dream Babies Go Hollywood, didn't go anywhere. And at the time of our interview, John Stewart, a victim of personal integrity, the record slump, or perhaps just fate, was without a record company once more. For me, no artist's music has touched deeper or been more ahead of its time. And I'd like to think that by the time someone hears this show, he'll have another record deal. Because one thing I do know, we haven't heard the last of John Stewart.
The only thing that I found that can really keep me going now, and I think keep anybody going, is to have a dream of some kind. When I need something, I just create a dream. And I have this dream now of doing a record that sounds a certain way. And there's so much luck and so much fate involved. I'm a real fatalist that I really don't know what's going to happen in the next year. But I do know that I'm not going to be doing this a whole lot longer. What I will be doing is the question.
When the lights go down in the California town, people are in for the evening. I jump into my car and I throw in my guitar. My heartbeat time with the breathing. Driving over Canyon, singing to my soul. There's people out there finding music in the gold. Body Jim Bass, he's a working pump of gas, and he makes 250 for an hour. He's got rhythm in his hands as he's tapping on the cans, sings rock and roll in the shower. Driving on a can, singing to his soul. There's people out there turning music into gold.
People out there turning music into gold.
The special of the week on John Stewart was written and produced by Sally Weinstock, series producer Alan Daniel Goldblatt. Our directors were Lee Hansen and Stu Jacobs, our engineers Ron Shapiro and Mike Williams. The special of the week is produced and distributed by Watermark Incorporated, executive producer Tom Rounds. Next week on the special of the week, Boz Skaggs.
It's a source of worry, and I don't really need anything more to worry about. Not that I have many things to worry about.
That's Boz Skaggs. Next week on the special of the week. The special of the week has been brought to you by Michelob. Weekends were made for Michelob. I'm Robert W. Morgan. Thanks for listening.